greetings, greetings, and salutations, one and all. Welcome, 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 welcome to the Night Shift to DJ Kevin Stew. It's the end of the Night Shift week. How you doing? How you doing? How you doing? Strange things are happening. Very strange. All right. Yeah, we'll fix that though. How you doing? We made it to the end of the Night Shift week. It's the night where we do a thing we call Marlon's Favorite Night Shift Show. And tonight... It's real talk for those of you who don't know what that which show that is. And tonight we continue along the lines of looking at toxic relationships and how they're identifying them. And tonight specifically we're looking at how toxic relationships affect children. But before we get into that, we're going to kick it off with a little music, a little bit of soca. Like we normally do. Kicking it off with Tedison John and International Steven. It's called Vent.
Yo, Teddy, say what you want to say.
Something on my chest. I want to express it. Let me ask you a question.
What do you have on your chest?
I want to say. I want to say what I want to say. Can I say?
I should work on getting it off, eh?
I really want to say it.
Take this opportunity to say thank you to Pulse Media Group for sponsoring this segment of the show. When being in the moment is priceless, give them a call 754-999-6020 or pulseemg.com. Go visit them on their website. Tell them you heard about them on the Night Shift with DJ Kevin Stew.
Ballet.
864. There's a lot on your chest. Oh, as in you have a lot to say on this topic that we're looking at today. Okay, cool. We welcome all views. Remember, this is a judgment-free zone. And numbers to call, numbers to text, numbers to get you in touch. 773-789-STEW, 773-789-7839. And of course, you are always invited to jump on into the Stew Pot. What is a Stew Pot? It is the interactive portal that mere mortals call the chat room. We're fancy on kevinstew.com, so we call it the Stew Pot. Just go to kevinstew.com and the Stew Pot is right there. You can't miss it. That's where we're interactive. That's where we get the discussion going. If you want to remain anonymous, feel free. Either way, you won't be judged. It's judgment-free here. Without further ado, I would like to introduce the man of the moment, my guest for tonight. He's no stranger to the night shift, but he's been away for a while. So it's kind of like having him for the first time. It's the first time this year, so that counts as something, I'm sure. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you none other than the man himself, psychotherapist extraordinaire, Sonny Etienne.
Good evening to you, doctor. Good doctor. How you doing? How you doing, DJ?
I'll take it from you. Coming from you, I'll take it.
good doctor.
Speak it into being, brother. Speak it into being.
So it is written, so it is.
That's right. How you doing?
Doing quite fine. How about yourself?
I am well, sir. Trust and believe I am well. Pushing through and making it do what it do.
That's what we gotta do, you know?
That's right. For the past few weeks, Sonny, I've been talking about toxic relationships. But before I get into why you're really here, I'd like for you to just quickly give a little bit of an overview to the new people. Because I have some new listeners since the last time you were here. So just go ahead and just reintroduce yourself to the ones that know you and introduce yourself to the new ones.
Certainly. Well, first of all, say hello to the listening audience. I'm glad to be back on the show, being able to offer some of my expertise and my experience and knowledge in the field. Want to also welcome all the new listeners that are new to me, at least. I'm a psychotherapist. I work with adults, couples, families, children, and I try to treat all varying mental health or behavioral health problems on a regular. I work both for a community-based agency as well as a private practice that I run here out of Broward County. So that's a little bit about me.
Cool beans. Now, the last time I had you on the show with me, we were talking about parental alienation.
Yes, sir.
And that was an awesome series. And it's kind of funny that I didn't plan to really do a series on toxic relationships. It just turned out that way. And so first I looked at identifying triggers or recognizing the characteristics of a toxic relationship, and we looked at identifying individuals, how they behave, the traits of individuals who are, I don't want to call the individuals toxic, but their behavior toxic, and how to identify such behaviors. And then last week I had Jess Jefferson with us. The week before that, I looked at
how to move away from toxic relationships, what the process of getting moving on from it, even if the toxic person is you yourself. And now we're looking at the effects of toxic relationships on children, because more often than not, we overlook the innocents, the ones who really have nothing to do with anything as it relates to these relationships, but they get caught up in the crossfire. So I thank you for taking the time out to come and talk with us on this matter.
It's really my pleasure to be here.
Because
appreciate you having me on the show.
Yeah, man. Because I know you have some experience in this area, and it's dealing with families and all. So I have to ask, how often have you come across children that have come into your office, children of families that you can see where the parents, the relationship between them is real hostile, it's really toxic, and then you have to deal with the children?
How often?
Yeah.
Let's just say today alone, two of them. Yeah.
Wow.
So, yeah.
You don't have to go too far.
Nah, not at all.
Jeez, boy, that's serious.
It is. It is because, you know, there are children. There are parents. And as long as we have children and we have parents, and as long as humans are humans, in which, you know, they have a tough time getting along or difficult time figuring out things such as conflict resolution or just relational agreement, there's going to be the effect, whether on children or surrounding parties, some friends, you name it. You know, the toxic relationships have a way of spreading, you know, and having an overarching effect on those around. Those involved in the toxic situation.
Yes, yes.
So, by and large, I treat this particular matter quite frequently. In fact, today I was working with a child and her parent regarding this very issue. It's a case in which parents are divorced, but the ripple effect of that divorce is still impacting the child.
Mm.
You know. Just the other day, I was with an adult client with her mother, and that issue came up, like the toxic relationships that you were involved in and how it had an overall impact on me, even to the extent that today I make choices in relationships that is very similar to that of you, Mom. So, yeah, it's not just younger kids. You can see the long-term effect on that kid who now becomes an adult and enters into a toxic relationship, or themselves are intoxicated. And,
wow. You know, I didn't even consider that part of it. Because, yeah, children grow up. you know. So
And children do as they see.
Yes. So you just added another dimension to the show for tonight. So we're going to have to address the young children in these relationships. And we have to address adult children of toxic relationships.
Big time.
So
big time.
It's your night. I'm facilitating because you're the man with the expertise. So
okay.
Where do you start when it comes to
I think the good place to start is to first let's define toxicity. I mean, the word is thrown around.
Yeah.
I think we need to try to get a good working definition of what we're talking about. So here's one that I found that I thought really speaks to it. By definition, a toxic relationship is a relationship characterized by behaviors on the part of a toxic partner.
Mm-hmm.
And they are characterized by they are both emotionally and not frequently physically damaging to their partners, while a healthy relationship, on the other hand, contributes to a person's self-esteem. It helps a person out in terms of their emotional well-being. A toxic relationship, on the other hand, damages a person's self-esteem and it drains another person.
Right.
Whereas a healthy relationship involves a mutual caring, respect, and compassionate. There's a lot of empathy there. There's an interest in a partner's welfare and their growth.
Yes.
And an ability to share control. The idea is to share control with decision-making as opposed to taking over and just, you know, overwhelming or imposing one's will and one's way of doing things, seeing things.
Mm.
It's poisonous in that the other person is stifled. The other person pretty much dies in
right.
order for this person to pretty much live and to thrive.
Mm-hmm,
so it's like the loss of mutuality speaks to the level of toxicity within that relationship.
Mm.
So I think a good working definition is good for us just so that we lay the groundwork so we're very clear as to what it is we're talking about and what these children have to live under.
Right.
So what they're seeing is a lopsided relationship in which there's a power struggle or a lack thereof. There isn't a sense of complementary where she compliments him and vice versa. It's one dominates.
Right,
and
right,
once you have a dominating relationship, it's not a healthy one. Now, for some people in some cultures, that's the norm, you know?
This
of course,
is true.
In many patriarchal societies, the man is the quote-unquote head of the house,
mm-hmm.
and what he says or...
That's all there is to it.
That's it. You know, if he is, you know, the end all be all, and
right.
that's, and the buck stops with him. And then there are other, you know, situations in which, you know, the female partner might be the one who is controlling. And I go back to the word control because I'm very much influenced by the work of William Glasser. William Glasser is a psychiatrist who is the father of what is called reality therapy, or what is popularly known as choice theory. And he says that all behavior is chosen, all behavior.
Mm-hmm.
And he goes on to say that one of the greatest attempts made by partners within a relationship, in particular marriage, is to exercise external control. It's trying to impose one's will on the other.
On the other party.
And a person may not even, and a partner may not even realize that they're doing it because they mean well. They mean well. But how is it coming out? How is it being delivered? What is the tone? Moreover, what is the underlying intention? And that's where we start to see just how poisonous that level of control could be
so,
on the other person when they lose a voice and lose their identity. Mm-hmm.
You're saying that in their control of their partner, they actually mean they're actually trying to do something good.
And in their mind. And so you say, for example, a part, often couples fight over finances.
Right.
And so you'll see one partner distrust the other's ability to effectively manage finances. And so they relinquish or they take that power away.
Right.
And they put the partner on an allowance. Well, here's how much you can spend for the week and so forth. It's control. Even though from that person's even from that partner's perspective, no, I'm just budgeting.
Right,
but you
right, right.
Silence that person. Now, that can have a ripple effect, or it can have ramifications beyond just the finances, because in what other areas now is that partner now shutting down? And what other areas is that partner now saying, well, I have to trust this person. And now back to self-esteem, they now start to second guess, if not doubt themselves.
Right.
That's poisonous, because how does that benefit this partner as a human being, as an individual?
Mm.
And that's just the surface stuff. Of course, there are degrees of toxicity. You know, I've been privy to situations in which I remember this one partner saying to his other partner, saying to his partner, I'm better than you. You are beneath me. These were the words that I heard. And I remember just thinking like, well, wow, this, but that was the person's belief system, you know? And as I remember asking, you know, the person whom this was said to, how about your children? Are they around when your partner speaks like this? Oh, yeah, they hear it all.
Whoa.
I said, I just wonder, like, how do they view you now?
Right.
Well, they don't really respect me. They don't really see me. Or they start to see me the way that my partner sees me. It's so you can see the spread even there.
So, wow. The respect coming from those children now is little to none.
Dies out, you know, shortly there, you know, they're at some point. I mean, and here's where we can start to talk about children, because let's say I'm an 8-year-old and I happen to hear rumblings going on in mom and dad's bedroom. And when I go up there out of curiosity, dad has mom pinned to the bed and he's on top of her and he's calling her X, Y, and Z.
Mm.
As a kid, I'm conflicted. Like, do I step in? Because if my parent is the authority figure in my life, the disciplinarian in my life, it's as if now I become a parent or an adult for that minute because I have to play referee.
Right.
But I'm confused. Am I allowed to play referee? I'm a child. Do I have a say in the matter or do I stay out of it? So there's already one level of poison that's occurring right there. Confusion. Poison, confusion. Another element of it is, do I say anything? No, I'll just mind my business. But I don't say anything. Now there's another poison, guilt or blame. What role did I play in this? Am I causing my parents to fight? Maybe if I wasn't here. Maybe if I weren't born. Maybe if my parents didn't have me. Maybe I don't want to live here. I want to live somewhere else. Why can't my parents be more like these parents of my friends? And these are just some of the thoughts that I hear a lot from kids who are being raised in toxic homes.
Right. Jeez. some of those things, you only hear about them in the movies, or you might read about it in a book or something. But when you hear someone like yourself come and talk about, hey, I have heard individuals talk like this, and they've done it in front of their children, that's crazy. Well, to those that it is not the norm, it would seem abnormal. Like me, I think that's just kind of, to say it for lack of a better word, that's just crazy.
Well, here's the thing. What appears to be crazy for one is someone else's norm.
Right.
And so let's take now, let's say a 14-year-old who has heard and seen this type of behavior since the age of, say, 5. By age 10, that child is totally accustomed to this. His parents fighting, okay, shut my door, put on my headphones, or, you know, put on my headset and escape into my world of video games. I've moved on, you know? This is just my parents, you know what I mean? And you'll hear kids talk that way. That was just my parents being my parents. So they become numb. They're inoculated to the toxicity. They're probably not even aware that this is dysfunctional anymore because this is all they know.
Right. It has become their norm. So, yeah, you're right.
Yeah. So what is crazy to you is absolutely normal to another family.
And
for lack of better terms, this is the culture within the home. This is how the family functions.
And, well, on one hand, it keeps a paycheck coming to you. On the other hand, that's not a paycheck that you'd probably want to have.
Well, and it's sometimes a case. It's also sometimes a case you don't even want to have, because I think of so many cases, but I'm going to look at one in which family is well-to-do, you know, come from an affluent background and so forth, but the level of toxicity within the home has brought police into the home a couple of times. There are strained relationships across the family lines between of course mother and father, between father and son, and then between father and daughter. And even trying to get them to communicate in an effective way when they're in my office sometimes proves difficult, because this is how we talk. And of course, for the first session, everyone's on their best behavior. But right, as soon as they're comfortable,
it comes out.
And you want it to come out. You want it to come out because we need to assess the degree of toxicity. Because, of course, we're going to eventually touch on this. There are some toxic situations that are beyond repair. And it's best, not just for the child, but for the individual, to part ways. It is for the best, you know. There are some homes in which the infestation has reached a degree where it's, we've got to tear down the walls and we've got to go in, because the mold, if you will, has so spread, and it's a lethal type of mold that it's unlivable.
Right.
That's what happens with some relationships. It's so toxic. And sometimes we think of it, well, domestic violence, because there's physical abuse. I tell you, if there's one thing that I hear a lot of, it's that verbal abuse, or what we call emotional abuse.
Right.
That's just the run of the mill. You hear about that like on a regular, you know. It's the things that my parent says to me or to each other. It's those words. They scar me. I don't even know how to heal from that. I can heal from a physical scar.
Right.
But it's those emotional whips with those words that come out of his or her mouth. And so, you know, I look at it from the perspective of the level of dysfunction, if you will. Sometimes it's to the extent that the family is best just, at least a couple, just separating, divorcing if need be.
Okay, now let's say that is what is called for in the relationship, that the couples separate. Now, more often than not, there is one couple, one of the parents, that is the one that is displaying the toxic behavior. Now, with a separation like that, they're still the parents, which means more often than not, especially in the state of Florida, where courts are going to say, okay, let's develop a parenting plan, the child will be with both parents at some point in time or another. Whether with the mother for X period of time and the father for Y period of time, whichever way it's going to go, that child is going to have to be with both parents. What is it like for you working with that child that has to go to that parent that their behavior is the toxic, and then transition back to the other parent who is the one that is quote unquote normal?
Let me think of this one. Yesterday, so I was with a parent. She's no longer with the partner, and so they're exes.
Right.
And one struggles with alcoholism, and there was an issue with the child in which the one parent said, you know what, go stay with the other parent, the one who has a drinking problem. Well, alcoholics are going to do one thing, and that's one thing that we can count on, and that's what?
They're going to get drunk. Yeah.
They're going to get drunk. Well, that's exactly what happened. And so now this one parent had to make a decision, like, do I just bring the child back home? Because I've sent the child pretty much to the lion's den. And I increased the risk now of my child developing alcoholism. And now I'm pretty much perpetuating a family problem. Or do I just stomach the situation and have the child with me and kind of try to do as best I can as a single parent now, even, or even if it's a stepfather involved, to try to parent this kid? It becomes increasingly difficult. You know, I'm just going, kind of goes back to the whole parental alienation that you and I even touched on in previous shows.
Right.
The parent is because now from the, let's say it's the alcoholic parent. Oh, you're controlling. You're taking my time away from my child. But the reasoning behind I'm taking the child is not because I'm trying. It's because you're not good for my child. You're toxic. In this case, you're intoxicated. So that's why I don't want you around my child, around our child, if you will. I have to be fair to the other parent, despite the addiction.
Right.
Our child. So it's not always easy. And that's where, of course, you got to, you know, that's when you pay a visit down to the county courthouse. And then you try to rework, you know, the shared time situation. And you know, because it's an obvious problem that's there. And it's a problem that isn't going to just go away by one's, you know, wishful thinking that it's going to go away. It has to be addressed. It has to be talked about, you know. But given, again, that the person's problem, so let's say it's a person, maybe it's not drugs. Maybe it's a person who is just emotionally unavailable to the child.
Right.
It's too busy working.
Mm-hmm.
And the child is maybe left to him or herself. So the child's picked up from school and spends a day or two, but it's primarily home.
Right, by themselves, yeah.
There you go, latchkey kid. And so a parent is pretty much stuck in trying to figure out the parent that really cares and doesn't want this for the other. You know, and that's where, where do we find effective co-parenting? And that, you know, Kevin, is a real challenge for a lot of parents with exes and trying to, you know, adequately raise, you know, raise a child. Yeah, it's a very difficult thing. So yeah, I see, you know, parents that come into my office to try to, Sonny, what do I do with my ex? He or she is just not complying, not making it easy, you know. And moreover, even though we're separated, like, the person hasn't changed; they're still toxic,
right?
You know. In fact, sometimes, you know, I heard this again today. All you do is talk negative about my mom. So I don't want to be around your dad, you know? This happened.
Mm.
Or vice versa.
Right.
You know, mom, you've never said one good thing about my dad. It's always, he ain't this, he ain't that. Or so, like, it makes me feel a particular way about my father because of how negative you speak about. But my experience with my father is not because what? You experienced him as a boyfriend or a girlfriend or a husband or wife. I experienced him as a mother or father.
Right.
And you're tarnishing that for me because of your personal experience. Right. So that's why sometimes a child is torn, like as if they need to pick a side.
When a child is going through things like this, what are some of the results that you would see? What are some of the behavioral or learning patterns that you would typically see happening with that child?
One of the main things that I see is, and I hear it from you know, a lot of young people that I work with, is I don't care. I used to care when I was younger. Oh, Sonny, stop trying to get me to open up about stuff like that. That's in my past. I'm over that. So a lot of them harder. They get harder.
So they don't care about that particular thing, or they don't care about anything?
About that particular thing. They don't want to deal with it anymore. It's like they're tired of it.
Mm-hmm.
Often I hear them say, I want to talk about my parents, you know? that's them. I don't care. That's their fight. That's their issue. They're adults. Especially the older they get, they become more self-centered and more about their own world. They don't even have time to deal with it. Right. It becomes a problem when there's physical, or it's a problem, or it matters to them a lot of times. And I don't want to generalize all kids, right. But in the case of teenagers, often what I hear is, I wish my parents would both, you know, let me get an iPhone 10 or a Galaxy 11. Mm-hmm, all mm-hmm. of a sudden, they want both parents on the same page because they're trying to get something. Or as they get accustomed to the pattern of negative interaction between the parents, mm-hmm. they start to manipulate the situation. Mm. Oh, yes. Yeah. Kids start to learn to manipulate. You know, I've got one parent who's more permissive and will let me get whatever I want. I've got another one who's really tough on me. And then you'll even see things like one parent buying a kid whatever the kid wants.
Yeah.
Not just because he or she wants to, you know, gift the child with something. It's to compete with the ex, you know, or to just dig into the, you know, as we're being spiteful. You know what? I'm going to spend $800 on this phone just to get on your nerves. You know, and so I see all of that. And so I think, you know, there's the preteen experience, and then there's the teenager's experience of dealing with parents who are at odds. It evolves into something different as a kid gets older.
Right.
Some kids get very closed in and isolated. I've seen that as well. It truly affects them. Their emotional development is somewhat stunted to some extent.
So I think
you had a question for me.
They kind of just retreat into their shells and become.
Yes.
So they become like. what's that word that I'm looking for? They keep to themselves in school.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And they withdraw from crowds and they become socially awkward.
In some cases, yes. There was this one kid I was working with. His parents divorced, and he was mad at the father, and he blamed the father for the divorce.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that I remember, you know, learning from the kid and the mother confirmed it, is that he felt that now he needed to be the man of the house.
Mm.
And so he took on a new role, even as a young 12-year-old or 11-year-old, whenever the divorce occurred.
Right.
And so some kids are forced to grow up quick. That's another effect of it as well. And another case is, you know, going back to the kid that isolates.
Yes,
and then go into a shell. Their shell is their bedroom, if it is a bedroom. And of course, for some others, that shell is substance abuse. Kids vaping, smoking,
right.
getting into, you know, underage drinking. Here's one for you. This is important. I really want to speak this to the listening audience. Of parents. Relationship, like after they've separated mm-hmm. and moved on to like someone new, you better believe your kid is watching, and that is impacting the child. I was with a kid last week who was telling me, young kid, 14 years old, well, he's 15, he was telling me, the reason why I started breaking into cars and going around the neighborhood and doing what I was doing is because my mom didn't have time for me. My mom was too busy entertaining other guys, and I figured that's what's more important to her. And that really hit me, because I was like, but why get into criminal behavior? Well, because she wasn't getting me the things that I wanted. And number two, I figured I might get her attention finally.
Right.
You see? So, again, even the behavior, and this is not to knock women, because this is often also fathers. In fact, I had one child that I worked with in the past who was explaining to me, she had a real hard time with her father getting remarried, because she was like, why are you picking someone else over me again? It's always someone else over us.
Mm.
You see, kids are paying attention. And what was interesting was the father wanted to repair his relationship with his daughter. And the daughter said, "That's it's too late. You know, I'm about to turn 18. You had your chance and you blew it because you were too busy chasing money and chasing women." And she told him this, you know, she told him this, and he was like, "Come on, that's unfair to me." She said, "I think it's very fair. When I was younger, I kept it. I was quiet, stayed in my room, mind my business. This is what I always felt." So a lot of times, you know, I don't think sometimes parents truly understand to what extent their decisions, you know, and how they
affect their children. Yeah. Someone asked a question. Someone asked a question in the pod. What kind of parents will the children themselves be to their children if they end up having families of their own?
Well, that varies. You know, I mean, the beautiful thing about the human mind is that it's very resilient. You know, people do the very opposite of what their parents did.
Right.
You know, a lot of times I'll hear kids say, "I don't want to be anything like my mom or like my dad." Mm-hmm, they're the worst example of what a parent is.
Should be, yeah.
Or should be. Yeah, I want nothing to do with that. And then, of course, then there's the other cases, you know, where monkey see, monkey do. This is how they did it. This is how I do it. You know,
right.
I had a mother tell me this. That originally, several mothers and fathers have said, "Sonny, we do as we know." You know, I experienced trauma. Okay, if my child experiences trauma, okay, you know, it happens. It's life. Tough it out. You know,
suck it up and move on.
And move on, because that's how I was raised. We can't sit there and wallow in misery or self-defeatism or have a pity party. You better deal with it, because tough times, you know, are ahead. And so as far as this, the child learns, you know, to deal with their emotions by not dealing with their emotion. And so their emotions come out in very unhealthy ways.
Right.
It manifests itself in anger, temper tantrums. Children learn self-centeredness a lot of times from their parents. Yeah, self-centeredness. I mean, sometimes even my own kids, "Daddy, you're selfish." kids are watching. And a lot of times I do self-disclose to parents to make them feel that, look, it's not that I don't get it. Look, I'm a father.
Mm-hmm,
I raise children. I have three of my own.
Right.
And so I think that drives home the point, you know, that I'm in there in the trenches just as they are. And so it's fighting for our children and doing whatever we can to ensure that they have as healthy as an upbringing as they can have. And so far as is within your power.
And that can be tough.
Provide them with.
That can be real tough, because
it takes two. It takes two.
Typically, you know,
yeah.
Especially since we don't really have that village raising the child anymore. So you definitely want to have the two. I want to take a quick little moment to recognize a sponsor for this segment of the show. Althea, thank you very much. Heavenly Healing Heavenly Hands. Althea is a licensed massage therapist, and she comes to you if you're in Broward County, South Palm Beach County, North Miami-Dade. You can give her a call, 954-655-9000, 954-655-9000, and she'll come to you. And she has oils. She has her table. All you got to do is set up a time and a day, and the rest she'll take care of it. So give her a call. It's Althea, 954-655-9000, or you can email her at thealater@att.net. That's thealater@att.net. All right, so Sonny, here we are. We have the young child that has gone through some of these experiences. Do you see it, or young child into teen child, so your school age child.
Yes, sir.
Do you see this kind of thing showing up in their academics, the effects of these toxic relationships? Does it show also in academia?
It's hard to determine that definitively because there's so many other factors, you know, to look at when you see academic challenges or struggles, that I think it's difficult to say that it is entirely due to parenting issues because of toxic relationships between fathers and mothers. I think a lot of time, and we can't just say fathers and mothers, because sometimes it's fathers and mothers and mothers. But
yeah, nowadays we have to be more politically correct and say parents.
Yeah, you're just parents, you're right. So I think it's across the board that a lot of times it's a bunch of different causes that best explain why a child is having academic issues. But for the sake of tonight's conversation, we will look at how the toxic relationship between the parents can play into that.
Mm-hmm.
I think from what I've seen in my years of doing this work is that when kids don't want to go home, they join sports, they join this club, that club, because they're not happy at home.
Right.
And the parent thinks that the parent might think the kid is just, you know, is just super active and just wants to be involved in everything, not realizing sometimes they don't want to be around the fights.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
sometimes the fights interfere with the child's ability to focus because they're not, depending on, again, on the level of toxicity, they're not sure what kind of situation they're going to be walking into tonight.
Right.
They don't know what that kind of mood dad's going to be in tonight. So it's kind of like they live on edge and they walk on eggshells. And school is just like another place where, especially if there's issues at home, when you go to school and you got to deal with some knucklehead who's probably a bully, or deal with a teacher that you don't necessarily like, or moreover, deal with a subject area that you struggle in.
Right, right.
You see, so it's compounded. It's not, I don't think it's just the situation at home, but the situation at home, I think, would be a primary issue or a factor to look at with why children sometimes do have academic problems.
I was going to ask, if there ever a time when, or do you see it where it goes the other way around, because they're using education as a means to get away, as an escape, they excel. So it appears that everything is going well with them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I definitely have seen that. But even then, I would say you just have a kid who's just self-motivated and a kid who's just that interested in academia, on top of the fact that they actually maybe enjoy being part of DECA and they enjoy being part of the chess club or the Greek club or drama. And so that is a getaway. Mm-hmm. But on top of that, you know, and it's something that I hear a lot. I do well in school and focus on school because I can't wait until I turn 17 or 18 so I can get the heck out of my parents' house and not have to live in that dysfunction.
But does that child then end up being that adult that becomes a workaholic?
I think could. I mean, there's definitely the potential for that to occur. You know,
it seems to because with that being a getaway from them, it becomes their safe place. And so it kind of like their cocoon, their shell, and they take that shell with them wherever they go. So now they're getting through high school and it's their getaway, their academia is their getaway, and they get into college. And because of doing it for so long, it has become that part of them. Or the opposite happens.
Yeah,
they are now in college and they feel free and they drop all that academia stuff?
That can definitely happen. Because and that's why I said it's a myriad of factors that we have to look at, you know, even in that particular case in which a child will go off to school and it's a different environment. You know, no longer do they have to hear or put up with mom and dad going at it.
Mm-hmm.
It's now they are in charge of their own lives. And they're going to experiment. They're going to explore. They're going to experience. Because they have exited. See, every word I just said starts with an EX.
Yeah.
Which speaks to the issue of out. And they want to get out, you know? And
right.
So whether it's through exploration of drugs, exploration of relationship, exploration of sexuality, exploration of just their belief systems. Oh, yeah. Well, here's how mom and dad raised me, but I don't know. I'm thinking differently about how I see things. They're figuring themselves out. And so a kid could, overwhelm him or herself into academics, just trying to escape. But it can have some long-term effects. In particular, with a lot of kids who are academically inclined, that I've seen is they struggle socially. You know, like they hit the books hard,
right?
But they don't necessarily have a lot of friends. You know, and they pretty much come home now. Now, so imagine it's already a rough day at school, but then I come home, and dad goes to his room, and mom is sleeping on the couch, and we don't eat dinner together. And so that's the norm. That's my life. So you have to look at now the emotional effect. Does this child know now how to connect with other people, in particular, in a relationship? You know, I've often heard people say, I didn't grow up in a home where we said things like, I love you, or we hugged, like, we didn't do all that mushy stuff. That's uncommon to me.
Mm-hmm.
And so now I don't know how to mount them. Sonny, all that stuff you see on TV and Disney Channel, like, that's corny. That's stupid. Like, I don't see myself doing
up.
All that. hugging my kid. For what? I take care of you. I put food on the table. I give you a roof over your head. Okay, that's love. Don't come here asking me, to have a kumbaya moment.
Right.
I don't do all that. And so that's all part of it, you know, if that's what a child knows. So, yeah, I could be so gifted, you know, in terms of scholastics, but I could be so ignorant in terms of my social development, you know. And so now I don't know how to forge or how to sustain long-term relationships. It can have a huge overarching effect on the child, particularly into adulthood.
Someone, it was posted in the pot, as adults we often become self-absorbed and not think of the effects of our behaviors on our children. Once they get to a certain age, some parents think that they no longer have to keep parenting.
Oh, yeah. I mean, and you have to look at culture. You have to look at, of course, that particular parent's background. But I definitely want to piggyback on what that caller stated. It's called selfishness. Let's just call it what it is. It's called selfishness. When a parent puts themselves before the child and they don't even realize it. And one way that they do it is this. They always have to be right. I'm the parent. I know better. You don't. They don't consider the child's feelings.
Right.
I have the privilege of sitting down with the children and their parents, and the child will thank me afterwards. That was the first time I ever got a chance to really speak my voice. I had this one kid I was working with. He was like, Sonny, my dad doesn't listen. It's pointless trying to get us to sit down with you, and we're going to try to resolve something. He's not going to listen.
Mm.
And in the middle of this, and then I said, look, let's just give it a shot. Give me a chance. Let's see how it pans out. And the father kept cutting him off, and the kid kept looking at me, you know, to give me that look like, you see that?
What I mean?
I told you.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I mean? I don't have a voice. I don't matter. I'm invisible. And then the father at one point picked up on it. He said, hold on. Did I give you a chance to talk? He was like, no. In fact, Dad, you never give me a chance to talk. And the dad said, I apologize. Apologizing to children is very important.
Oh, yeah.
It's not so much that you're humbling yourself. Yes, that's very important. But it's what I call the Triple H effect. If you want help, you got to have humility and honesty. And so once we humble ourselves, you know, we don't always have to be right. We don't always have to have the right answer. And then on top of that, we're just honest, just being truthful. I was wrong. I got it wrong, kid. You know what? You have a good point. By doing that, we're helping the child to maturate.
Yeah.
We're helping the child to, in the words of another great gentleman whose philosophies I am influenced by, Alfred Adler, the father of individual psychology, the child now begins to individuate. That is to become a whole person and self-actualize. But if it's always me, the parent, I know. I don't know.
Right. You know,
I think.
Go ahead.
No, I was just saying, children teach us. Children teach us if we listen to them.
Yes, they do. I, my 13-year-old, I was driving on Sunday as I was heading to church, and the boys are in the car with me, and it started raining. It was raining, and there was a guy driving a pickup truck, and he has to cover some equipment in the back of the truck. And I'm like, and I'm saying this out loud, why are you doing this now in the rain? Why didn't you do it before? Or why don't you drive down the road and stop at a gas station where it is covered and then do this? And he turned to me and he said, Dad, what's it to you? And I'm like, you know what? He said, why are you judging him? I was like, I got nothing.
I'm like, right.
You're right. You're right, son. You're very right. Thank you for that. Let me just keep my mouth shut and mind my own business, because that has nothing to do with me. And he was very right.
You know, I was a couple of Sundays ago, Oprah Winfrey on the OWN network, the whole Oprah channel, she had this thing called Soul Sunday or Super Sunday. Mm. And she had on her show that day as a guest, I just found this particular person's writings and very interesting. Her name is Dr. Shafala Tassaberry. I could be mispronouncing it. It's spelled, last name spelled Tassabary. She wrote a book called The Conscious Parent, which is transforming ourselves by empowering our children. So, and the book is written to parents. But she had a very, I guess, novel way of looking at parenting. But part of her theory was that children are a gift here to teach us a lesson. I was just like, this is pretty revolutionary, some of the stuff that she was talking about. Mm-hmm. It's not for everyone. You know, some people might feel that's too new agey or a little bit out there. But I found it fascinating. And so it's a book that, or her work, go on YouTube or just look into her stuff, that's worth looking at. Again, The Conscious Parent by Shafala Tassaberry. She's a PhD.
Okay.
And part of what she was saying is how children, again, it is kind of new agey and very Eastern, I guess, in its underlying philosophy, is that these children choose us prior to coming to this world, and that they're here to teach us.
Mm.
Our job is not to control them. In fact, she's completely opposed to parental control. Her whole thing is having a relationship with your child.
Right.
And I just found some of her concepts very interesting. Particularly because when I look at like a lot of the stuff that I hear from children when they come in for individual counseling, and then we touch on the nature of their relationship with their parents, they feel as if, you know, back to what we were saying, not having a voice, they feel stifled.
Mm-hmm.
And I can just constantly hear it. Whether the kid's going away to college or the kid just wants to just go to the military, or the kid just wants to get out. You know, a kid, the kid just feels like the parent only sees it his or her way and is unwilling to consider that they too think, you know? I've had certain kids say to their parents in therapy, "Mom, if I'm defiant or resistant, because you are, you're stubborn. This is how you raised me. You taught
right.
me to think for myself, and now that I'm thinking for myself,
you have a problem with it.
You have a problem with it." You yep. know, so I bring that up because I think what she was saying is that, you know, when we raise our kids, we're not raising them. She said, "That's in fact, she's even against that term. You're not raising the kid." You know, she said, "What we're doing is pretty much helping to guide the kid along their journey, and we are learning a lot from the kid as mm-hmm. we are on our journey."
Yes. Well, you know, if you're not learning, then you're stagnant. And anything that is stagnant is dead. So I can see where she's coming from with that.
Yeah.
You know, 864 says we need to break the generational cycle. It's something that these are the kind of things that our parents did and our parents' parents did, and they learned it from their parents. So we are kind of teaching it to our children. I think parents now are dealing with a set of children that are a little bit different. And they're different because of the amount of exposure that they're getting. These children know they are researching things for themselves. They have some questions. You know, parents used to worry about the child coming and asking about sex. Now a child is coming to teach a parent a thing or two about sex. And parents are being schooled, really, literally.
I think you hit something, you know, that's very critical in our day and time, because when parents are, let's say, busy arguing and fighting, and earlier I said, kid turns to a video game, another kid just turns on music.
Yeah.
And there's another kid that's on his or her phone surfing the net. And what's happening is this. Your child is being parented by their cell phones.
Right.
All the information. Yeah. Because whereas in times past, a child would turn to parents for answers.
Yes.
Or to, as you put it earlier, you know, the community or the village that's raising the child.
Mm-hmm.
That village is found right there at the tip of their finger on their smartphone or on their smart device. And what? So the parent has been replaced, apparently, by smart technology.
You know, in a sense, I do that, but I could be wrong in the way that I am doing it. So correct me if I'm wrong. My son would ask me about something, and I would say to both of them, I'd say to them, "Well, you have a device in your hand. Why are you not using that to look up the answer to the question that you're asking?" My older son said to me, "Well, because you're here and you can tell me." And I said, "Well, I can tell you based on what I know. How about you look up what you're asking and then we talk about it?" Now, I don't know if it makes a difference with that last part where we end up talking about it versus just saying, "Go look it up. You have the means to find the information. Go look it up."
I mean, the last part of it is good, but I think hearing your older, hearing, listening to your older son, what it sounds like he's saying is, Dad, I want to hear it from you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I want to get it from you because
right.
you are my primary teacher. Way before there was this thing called Wikipedia, I learned from you.
Mm-hmm.
You are my source. That's why I came to you. You know, and so when we default to a Wikipedia or a Google, we've right. missed probably a golden opportunity to connect with our child by letting them connect to the Wi-Fi internet to get information or to be parented by God knows who.
Now, here is where I kind of take some pride now. Last mm-hmm. night, my son said to me, the same one, the older one, he said to me, Dad, I want to come on your show. And I said, okay, what do you want to talk about? And he said, the education system. I was like, what about the education system? And he has a perspective on mm-hmm. how he's being educated and how his peers are being educated. And he wants to talk about it because he heard me talking about various issues on my show. And so he has an issue and he wants to discuss it on the show. And I was like, whoa, that is awesome. So
do you think that has something to do with the fact that he is being raised by a father who's using radio as a vehicle for change and to help and to speak into lives?
I would hope so.
Yeah.
You know, I truly hope so. But I told him, it's not going to happen tonight, but we're going to have that discussion. And he actually said, oh, cool, because I wasn't really ready to do that tonight. But I'm like, no, we're not doing it tonight. But you raise a valid point. This is a concern that you have. I've asked him to look it up. And I've said, come back, let's talk about it. And I'd ask, okay, so what is your opinion on this that you have read? I read about it, and this is what I am thinking, this is what I found, and we'd have a discussion about it. Is that something that in some toxic relationships, coming back to where we started, with toxic relationships and relating to the children in those relationships, the ones that you have met with, do you find things like that happening with both or one of the parents and the child? Do they have that communication? Do they have that dialogue on any level at all going on so that the child can connect with them?
Yeah, I think, you know, all of us, you know, myself included, as parents, we want to have it. You know, we long to be with our children. But I think a lot of your listening audience would agree, time.
Mm.
Time, jobs.
Yeah.
You know, I was watching this video by, he's a great poet. His name is Prince E.A.
Yes.
And he did something recently. Oh, yeah. Excellent.
Yes.
He did. On all the time that we spend at jobs that don't even care for us.
We don't like.
Jobs that we don't even like. You saw it. Great.
Yeah, he started out asking the question, what time of day uh-huh. do we have the most heart attacks?
What time of day? You got it. That was a video. Yeah.
Yes.
You know, so to the audience, please go watch that video on YouTube. I want to support that young brother. Prince E.A. That's all I know. Prince
yeah.
E.A. I'm not yeah. sure how to pronounce it, but that guy's pretty artistic. But yes, yeah, to answer your point, though, it's, I think parents would like to have those conversations. But just time doesn't allow it. And what's so sad is it's when you're at your 18-year-old's graduation and you realize just how fast time.
Yeah.
You know,
and how much you missed.
You missed it. And so that's why I told you even the other, when your son came to you, that was an opportunity to take the time to, you know what? Here's what I think, kid. But tell you what, let's go see what other people think on the internet and do it with him.
mm-hmm.
because we're still spending time together.
Right.
Time. That's what this is all about. You know,
mm-hmm.
it's the gift. You know, there's an old saying that I heard years ago. Yesterday is history. Tomorrow's a mystery. Embrace today. Today is a gift. That's why it's called the present.
Yes.
It's a present. It's a gift to us. And so let's seize the day. Carpe diem. Let's make the most of our time. In this case, related to tonight's subject, time with our children. You know, earlier this evening, I just went out shopping with them to Home Depot and to buy certain things.
Mm-hmm.
And you could tell they were there picking flowers with me, picking plants. They were just spending time with me.
Right.
And then on top of that, they were like, Dad, tomorrow's 4th of July. Are you off? I was like, I am off. Yeah. and that's what I will never be able to get back. Those, Dad.
Right.
Because
right.
then, you know, my children will be, you know, before I know it, they'll be 20. And then they're, mm-hmm. and now they're busy with time. Because now they don't have time for me.
Right.
But so you see how this whole opportunity is missed?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have time for them when they were young because I was so busy working. And now that they're adults, young adults, they don't have time for me. And I'm now retired.
Mm.
We missed it. We missed the opportunity. And so we're not off course, off course, by the way. We're still talking about the impact.
Yeah.
On children with toxic relationships.
Right.
Well, part of the toxicity in that regard now has to do with families that don't spend time together, which is probably why they're arguing and fighting and why it's so toxic.
Right. This is true.
That's another factor, you know, because now what does that child learn? Work, or don't be home. Because how mm-hmm. many partners don't want to come home because they don't want to argue with their partners?
Right. Yeah.
Time. We don't spend time together. Or we don't take time to really fix our issue. Or to address our issue.
Which takes me to something that we touched on earlier with the mm-hmm. adult child that has been the victim or that has experienced this toxicity in relationships. You said you've had a client as an adult that has expressed that very same thing, being, you know, it is as a result of you, mom, dad, that I am this way today as an adult. What are some of the, how does it look with you dealing with some of these cases? What do they typically look like?
Well,
or is there a general look?
I'm sorry.
Is there a general look?
I think there's multiple looks of what it looks like.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of anger. Oh yeah,
mm.
I'm angry at my parents. There's a lot of resentment. Mm-hmm. On the part of the parent that was unavailable or just stayed. Oh, here's one: stayed in a toxic relationship. There's a lot of regret.
Yeah.
There's a lot of tears. That's why I have to have a lot of Kleenex because there's a lot of weeping and a lot of crying that goes on, sobbing that goes on in my office and in my therapy sessions where people get a chance to really, you know, express emotions that, you know, truly have an impact on them. And so what it looks like is sometimes just sadness. Depression, because now there's a very poor adult-child-parent relationship. They don't really know how to connect.
Right.
We didn't have it when I was younger, you know? Or you and Dad were so busy fighting, at some point I checked out, and you never even realized I checked out,
mm-hmm,
you know?
Mm-hmm.
One of the behaviors, I know you asked me about certain behaviors seen in children that can even persist into adulthood. And it's very common nowadays with a lot of children, in particular with girls I'm seeing. And that is self-harm, cutting behaviors. Or here's something else as it relates to mental health. So if, let's say, one parent is just depressed but stays in the relationship. Now you have a case of that child now is developing certain like symptoms. You know, well, what does mom do when she's sad or upset? Mom's in her room all day. So now what do I do? I pretty much mimic what I've seen.
Retreat.
I'm now in my room.
Right.
There you go. How did dad deal with his issue? Well, dad would pretty much stay out the house. You know, I didn't see him much. Well, why would I want to be home? The house is, mom is sad. I don't want to be around her. So I'll do what dad does. I'll just be out hanging out with friends, getting into God knows what. Mm. And then you see it, again, extend into adulthood. You know, so persons are now unavailable to their children. And so you see it becomes cyclical, or if not generational. So right. Interesting, you know, I'll work with families in which you'll see a grandfather displaying behaviors very much consistent with his great-grandson.
Mm.
You know, in the church world, they would call that generational curse.
Yeah.
In the field of psychology, we call it family patterns.
Right.
So it definitely looks many different ways, but I've just given you just a few that I've seen, and there are a host of others that I could, you know, expound upon. But I think the listening audience kind of gets the picture, and I'm sure many of them can totally relate. You know, I'm sure many people listening in tonight are seeing themselves in some of the stories that I told.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, definitely. I didn't consider some of the areas that you had touched on, and I want to thank you for bringing your expertise once again to the Night Shift. It's always welcome, Sonny. You're truly appreciated, loved for doing what you're doing and sharing with us as you can when you can.
No problem. If
any of our listeners want to get in touch with you, how can they do so?
Certainly, yeah. You know, I operate now from one primary office out in Tamarack. I'm located off 8400 North University Drive in the city of Tamarack, 33321. I could be reached at area code 954-774-2201. Again, that is 954-774-2201. You can also find me at introspectivecounseling.net. Again, I'm sorry, that's introspectivecounseling.net.
Mm-hmm.
You can find me there. And yeah, that's pretty much how to get a hold of me. I offer, again, individual, couples, family, children, psychotherapy. I take most major insurances. So please reach out if you're a person who's in need. That and it doesn't just have to be the issue of toxic relationships. It's anything that ranges from dealing with depression, dealing with a failed marriage, difficulty raising a child who is just taking a bad turn. Maybe you're a person out there who's confused about your faith, don't know what you believe anymore. A person who's confused about what's the next career move to make, as not just a licensed clinician, but also as a life coach.
Mm.
I'm here to help you figure some of that out. So definitely reach out to me, Introspective Counseling Services. I want to thank you again, DJ Kevin, for having me on. So it was a great pleasure of mine, been an honor, to be quite honest with you, just to be able to share this time with you and your listening audience.
Hey, listen, it's my pleasure. I am looking to talk more about matters relating to this, and it's funny that I'm looking at how toxic relationships affect children, and this month is Child Mental Health Awareness Month.
There you go.
And it was just this evening that I saw something about that on social media, and I was like, huh, look at that.
Yeah.
Must be divine intervention.
Well, that and also, Kevin, you're a man who's just concerned about the well-being of others. I mean, you utilize your platform to address people issues. And
yes.
So whether it was Breast Cancer Month in the month of November, or whether it's, in this case, you know, children's mental health, because you're in that arena of trying to help people, whether you and I were having this show, you know, during Christmas, or
yeah.
whether, you know, not you and I, but just you,
yeah,
you know, because you do this labor of love, you know, throughout the year. And so
this
I think
true.
For you, in your case, to commend you, whether it's today or this month of July, or whether it's, you know, Veterans, you know, Day,
yeah.
or, you know, you are doing something that speaks to people's needs and what people are looking for. So
I thank
divine
you.
Divine intervention, yes, but I think maybe you're walking in your calling.
Yes, so I try to.
If you're walking in your calling, then my brother, it's always going to be divine.
Right. I just got a message here. So here it is. Someone is saying, I want to reveal that I'd prefer to not even consider marriage until after my 13-year-old turns 18. She has had me as a single parent since birth. I believe the adjustment would be too difficult. Various people don't agree with me on this idea, but I am very comfortable with it. Have you had any clients come in where they're as single parents, this is the view that they're having, and their child possibly saying something else contrary to you, but not to the parent?
I mean, I'll personalize it, you know. That was my mother.
Oh.
After my father walked out and left,
mm-hmm.
my mother made a conscious decision that I'm not going to remarry or bring another person into my children's life. And she remained unmarried to this day. She never got remarried.
Mm.
And as a child, I remember just feeling bad for my mom, wanting her to have someone, seeing other women, you know, adult women, and seeing how some of them remarried and moved on with their lives. So to that listener,
mm-hmm.
I mean, I get it. You have all the right intentions, but there's also your own well-being and also you wanting to be with someone. Now,
right.
again, I'm not here to tell you what to do.
Yeah.
It's your decision, and I respect it, but
it would be good to consider these other things.
To consider, because, you know, you don't want to look back years from now, and I had a good opportunity with this person, but I made this sacrifice. Run it by the child, because like me, I wouldn't mind having had a decent stepfather had I had one.
Just a
little monkey wrench to mess up your night.
Oh, she added this to it, especially after dealing with psychogenic non-epileptic seizures. I couldn't get that word out for nothing.
Okay, no worry.
They added, that was what was added. Especially after dealing with psychogenic non-epileptic seizures. I wonder if that had anything to do with the...
I had a lot to do with it. In that case. Well, then I would say, you know, try to avoid the epileptic, try to avoid the psychotic. And that's being just a wise and being a good steward of your wisdom. You know, sometimes we squander and waste our wisdom, but you want to utilize it wisely. You know, don't throw it to the pigs.
Right.
And so be very discreet and use discernment if you choose to consider what I stated earlier, which is, you know, there might be someone special out there for you who might come before 18 years old. You know, and
well,
just screen
30,
them,
no.
Vet them, make sure. The countdown is on, right? The countdown is on, but you know that Mr. or Mrs. Wright might pop up. around age 15. Around age 15, then what?
Right. You know, I guess, again, it comes back to the relationship that you have with your child. I guess that might be a great idea. You've not 13 to have that discussion with a child to say, hey, you know, how would you feel about me getting a partner in my life? How would you feel having a step parent? I think that's a great idea, Sonny. That's why you get the big bucks.
That's the reason why. Because I look at all factors. I try not to just see things through one single lens. You know, when they talk about be open-minded and to be objective, that there's a reason why. You want to take a look at everything. You know, my philosophy is introspection. And to be introspective for me falls under four categories. To have oversight, hindsight, foresight, and of course, insight. In this case, we're talking about oversight. See the bigger picture. Have foresight. And see into the future. What if I decide to go this route, and years from now, my kid tells me, that was your decision. If you can't find someone now at this age, don't come to me and try to blame me. I got nothing to do with it. That was your choice.
And these children these days, that's exactly how it comes out. Yeah, that's exactly. They speak their mind, boy. And you know what?
As they should.
Love it. I love it. I encourage it. I don't come down hard on my children for speaking their minds. I want them to speak their minds because then I know exactly what you're thinking. I know that you're not hiding anything from me. I know you're relating to me, and I'm getting the authentic you. I don't want anything but the authentic you, because that is what I am trying to give to you, the authentic me. So, Sonny, we're going to talk again because, like I said, I'm talking about this stuff constantly, and I don't think it's going to stop here. I really don't. Last week, I spoke to Jess Jefferson, the superheroes therapist, about men and mental health. And so, you know, it's for me, it's ongoing. It's ongoing because too much going on in our community. Way too much. And a lot of it can be tapered down if we would only understand each other and if we would only communicate a little bit better with each other. And knowing some of these things, being exposed to some of these things, I think makes a difference.
I agree. I certainly agree. You know, awareness. That's what it is. You know, today's what children's mental health awareness month. Well, that's what you're doing. You know, just informing and making the community aware. And as long as we can do that, I think we're doing our part to contributing to a society, to a world, to a community. Mm-hmm. I think that is well on its way towards healing and health, because that's, I think at the end of the day, what we all want for ourselves and what we want for our children, a healthy life.
Yeah. All right. So, Sonny, you have a good night. You have a enjoy your 4th of July with relaxing with your family.
That is the intention for tomorrow.
That's a good plan. That's an excellent plan, if you ask me. And we'll catch up. We'll definitely catch up. I won't wait until a year plus before you're back on this show.
No problem.
We have too much to talk about. I have somehow gotten a nice little collection of psychologists and psychotherapists that I should be able to call on somebody almost every week.
Good. Because there's a whole bunch of us out here, you know, with a lot to offer. So I'm happy that you've given them a microphone to speak into.
Oh, yeah. And my platform is available for you. So.
Oh, sorry.
All right. Enjoy the rest of the night, my brother.
Yes, sir. We'll be in
touch. Take care. We will be in touch.
Yes, sir.
All righty.
Bye-bye now.
Psychotherapist Sonny Etienne. Look him up. Check him out. He's a nice guy. What you see is what you get. There's no show being put on there. We're going to take a quick little break. We haven't taken one all night. We're going to take a quick little break. When we come back, we'll get into musical therapy. It's musical therapy time right now. I want to thank JTMC Enterprise for sponsoring the previous segment also. So give them a call. They can handle your event management, your social media management, your promotions, your marketing. 678-793-8800. 678-793-8800. Or visit them at jtmcenterprise.com. Tell them that you heard about them from The Night Shift with DJ Kevin Stew. All right? We'll be right back after these few messages.
Pulse Media Group, innovative streaming and recording, has done it again. A new way to get your business in full view of your neighborhood consumer through AdShare TV. It's available in your neighborhood today. It's easy. Just call us. 754-999-6020. Become a host today and place a TV monitor in a strategic location so it's easy to see. Get a 1-minute video ad or longer that plays anywhere in our network. Can't be a host? No problem. For a few dollars, we'll run your 30-second video ad. A host can run announcement specials like buy one, get one free, or discount ads. Let's turn your flyers into a 30-second video with music or a voiceover. Or let us create and run your video ad with a spokesperson. Take advantage of our early enrollment discount. Join us today. Your ad will be seen at least 30 times per day in your AdShare TV neighborhood. It's easy. Just call us. 754-999-6020. AdShare TV, part of Pulse Media Group.
Are you crazy about the music industry? You aspire to hit it big in music? Or maybe you've sweated out a soulful killer beat and are now stuck finding it's not as easy as it looked? Oh, but it can be easy for you with JTMC. We've been there, we know how it feels. So we solve challenges like production, promotion, marketing, branding and development, and more. With over 30 years of experience, JTMC is a one-stop shop for artists. We handle your graphic design, writing services, PR, as well as event planning, e-blasts, artist management, and bookings, so also your website and social media needs as well. We're experts in using creativity to persuade audiences on behalf of artists, drawing on our diverse experience to create projects that connect with audiences intellectually and emotionally. Artist success is everything to us, and our years of experience and commitment will be behind you for every one of your needs. If you've got music for the world to hear, whether you're a new or established artist, visit us at jtmcenterprise.com.
Hey, I'm representing for DJ Kevin Stew. We're working on the Night Shift, the Night Shift radio show. Won't go changing like the weather, just to please the devil never. Will DJ Kevin Stew sell his soul? That's a word and honor. It's Christine to represent him. Word and honor. Celestia DJ Kevin Stew.
Twenty-three minutes before I get out of here for the rest of the week. Different side of Joanna Marie. Her piano rendition of Somewhere Out There. Thank you. you could stick around for the musical therapy 864. Thanks to GMAT Music Solutions for sponsoring this segment. Joanna Marie on keys, somewhere out there. This is new music from Jack Radix. It's called True to Myself.
She left again. I'm so tired, too weak to fight, wouldn't even try. But if the bell rings, I wonder what I'll do. I'll pick myself up off the floor, kick myself through the door. But if the bell rings, I wonder what I'll do. Will I be true to myself and whisper in her ear? Yes. Or will I lie to myself and leave her standing there? Yes, Lord. I'll get myself someone new, rid myself of this misty blue. But then the phone rings, I wonder what I'll do. I ask myself, hey, what's the use? Then I tell myself some silly old excuse. And then the bell rings, oh Lord, what do I do? Will I be true to myself and whisper in her ear? Yes. Or will I lie to myself and leave her standing there? Yeah. Oh, Shada.
Shada.
Shade.
Shade.
Lada.
Lada.
Shada.
New music from Jack Radix.
I'll treat myself to a brand new car. Drive me away to some place far away. But then the bell rings. What do you think I do? Oh, was I true to myself? Whispering in her ear, yes. Or was I lying to myself when I left her standing, yes, standing over thee? Shada.
Shada. I tell you, I just love it. This is Xavier Ward working out with Skip Marley. Track is called All I Am.
It can be whatever, I got you through it all. When you hurt and you know I feel it first, it's a blessing and a curse. I still got you through it all. Give you everything I am, by goes my plans. For you I'd risk it all. Give you everything I am, just take me.
This is Reggae Soldiers Paul Anthony. Working out with Will Tino. It's called Feel the Rhythm.
You feel it?
Let's feel the rhythm.
Let's feel the rhythm.
Feel the rhythm. Let's feel the rhythm.
Nice, sweet, fantastic. Hear the love, you're so physically fit. Oh, damn, your attorney shows. Her beauty's like 100 bunches of rose. Girl, we jamming, jamming, yeah, we jamming on down. From Palm Beach back to Kingston Town.
Say it!
Touch the street, I hear the sweet sound. Party turn up and we can turn down. Music a play, people jump around. Wine and go down in the dance hall. Oh, girl, I got me drunk like coconut rum. Drunk night to night, we can have some fun.
Bring your body closer.
Just come a little bit closer to me, just a little bit, just shift on over, just a little bit. Let's feel the rhythm, yeah?
Mami, qué rico. Let's feel the rhythm. Feel the rhythm.
You can't go wrong.
Let's feel the rhythm.
Just move to the beat.
Feel the rhythm. Let's feel the rhythm.
I make she say, oh yeah, bring it back again. Feel the rhythm, yeah, I heard on them. When you bring it back, so so, no one can touch you, girl, or you run the road. Where we long, girl, you don't see why not stop. Why? You got the fuego, take me to the top. No need no herbs or no white rum shots. Right now I'm floating high to black. Float. I love it when you run your hands through my locks. The summer soon done, but things just start get hot. Hot. Oh me, oh, oh my, let me look also fly. I really hope that you can give the eye and eye apply.
Hey. See your body closer.
This is Tory Mason.
Kiss me through the phone. Take a sippy
drink. Most of you know him as Deville. This is new track. It's called Kryptonite.
I don't share my feelings off. Feel I'm riding in a song. I need you. I need you.
Enzo.
Girl, I'm feeling
track called Come Over.
Cause I love you the same way, and I love you so much. I don't care what people say, it's complicated. Cause you got your man, girl. I just know that I want you. Show you, got some things to show you.
to show you what I give you pleasure. Searching for your treasure, I can be you, I can be you, everything you want. Tell me yes, tell me yes. I'll be all you want. Girl, just come on over, spend the night. It'll be the best, all you gotta do. Baby, just come over, let me be your lover. I can give you pleasure, I can give you pleasure. I will be your savior.
I'm crazy. When I look into your eyes, I mesmerize you, amaze me.
New music, courtesy of Groove Galore Music, featuring Maxi Priest and Danglin. It's called Say I.
What if I do to have you, to have you, to have you by my side? You make me say I.
I believe it's the end of the night shift week already. Whatever you're gonna be doing to celebrating to celebrate your fourth, I ask that you do it safely. I don't know if I said thanks to GMAC, but thank you very much, GMAC Music Solutions, for sponsoring the musical therapy segment. As we roll out to the night shift this week, I want to encourage you once again. Look out for members of your members of your community. I'm glad you're full joining the therapy 864. Your community is not that development that you live in, but it spreads far and wide. Those are those people that you pass on the bus, on the plane, on the boat, on the train, whether you walk, ride, or drive. These people are members of your community. So do something good for one of them today, because you never know who's gonna do something good for you tomorrow. My name is DJ Kevin Stewart, so I like to do it to you, for you, and with you every Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, 10 till midnight. Right here on kevinstew.com and affiliate stations. I'll be back next Monday.
With the perfect weather.
And we'll do this all over again for another week. I don't know. Depending on what the family decides to do, I might take some time out to drop some tunes, and we'll just enjoy some tunes.
what if I
don't know. Let's see what kind of permission I get.
To have you by my side. Africa.
Y'all take care of yourselves. And be good. But if you can't be good, you have my permission. Be good at it. Y'all take care. I want to say thanks, special thanks to Jillian, Jay, and crew. Once again, I get to show off my little bracelet. You can have one too. Just check out Jillian J. Jillian-J.com. Catch y'all on Monday. Take care, y'all.
The ability to share that moment. If you can video it, you can broadcast it. And Pulse eMedia Group has the tools you need. Weddings, birthdays, funerals, graduations, church services, parties, seminars, you name it. Pulse eMedia Group can provide you with a secure medium controlled by you to broadcast your event. Contact us at www.pulseemediagroup.com for more information. Pulse eMedia Group, when being in the moment is priceless.